when I left in 1969 for swift boat duty, and it was a pretty lonely feeling, and I had no idea what the hell I was getting into, other than I knew I was going to land in the middle of a war.
My daily thought when I woke up in the morning was first to thank God I was alive, and then how am I going to get through today?
It's the not knowing that gets to you. The feeling that you're never safe, anywhere, at any time.
Flying in from
everywhere. In 2017, we produced a film called Remembering Vietnam, taking the viewer back to 1967, 1968, 50 years ago. We at GSUTV decided that we wanted to do a film that conveyed the human emotion that one encounters during wartime. Not only soldiers, but all those people that get caught up in warfare, parents, brothers, sisters, and tell the story of how it divided America at that time.
When you think about the meaning of war and whether we should be there, there is a gap between those that make the decisions and those that do the fighting. There's a big gap.
I didn't hear about how people felt about us. When I did, I said, why, you know? We did it because you said it was the patriotic thing to do.
It was really hard. I got a little awakening when we landed in San Francisco, coming back, because we had a group of people meeting us, and they weren't cheering for us. They weren't cheering at all. They were saying nasty things to us and calling you all kind of names, you know. Baby killer, women killer, you know, which I'm sure they're right. That was rough.
The film aired on Veterans Day, America's Veterans Day, November 11th, 2017, and it was received very well. We got a lot of very positive feedback, submitted it for some awards and did win some awards for it. So we decided, as a group, my production team, that we wanted to do a follow-up. And that follow-up was going to be what it's like 50 years later for somebody who experienced Vietnam in the most horrific way.
My name is Joe Maharski. I went to Vietnam towards the end of 1967, I believe, on a destroyer escort, the USS Brister.
My name is John Teschner, J-O-N-T-E-S-C-H-N-E-R. I got notice that I had to show up for the Army August 7th, 1967.
We did look at maybe a dozen different veterans that we considered bringing back. But what I loved about John and Joe is that they represent two factions of the American people. Joe is from the middle part of America. He's from Ohio. Had very set moral codes and political outlooks.
I left early in April 1969, and Navy granted me a hardship discharge. It was my second tour in Vietnam, which I volunteered for both.
John is a very, very sensitive person. He's an artist. He had very, very strong anti-war feelings during Vietnam. But he got swept up in it, as a lot of people like myself did.
The reason they made me a medic is I told them I'm really against not only the war, but against killing, and that I really didn't want to be a part of that. I didn't carry a weapon the whole time because I knew my boys were all going to protect me. They wanted me alive more than I wanted me alive.
At the time, to me, it was just another event. It was just something that happened. And I didn't think about it, care about it one way or the other. And I guess I had just become numb, which most of us did, because it hurt too much to feel.
I don't talk about the war much. I've got it locked up in a little box in there, and I know where it is. I can go to it if I need it, but it doesn't dominate me. And
I'm gonna always have a mistress, and that's Vietnam itself. No, it's never left. And I don't really see how it could. I don't think that's a negative thing. It just, to me, is a natural reaction to the things that I went through over there. I remember my father once, he said, "Was it bad?" And I said, "Yes." That was the only thing he ever knew about what I did. My mother died in January. She never knew. I never told her.
Joe and John shared one thing in common with those who were shipped off halfway around the world. They arrived during the beginning of the end.
People had different experiences in Vietnam, but one common experience in the 1968-1969 period, primarily because of the Tet Offensive, and the North Vietnamese were infiltrating regular army forces into the South, that some of the fiercest fighting of the war occurred during this period. The ultimate tragedy of the battles that occurred in 1968 and 69, that those brave soldiers on both sides who fought during this period of an American withdrawal, it's a fair question to ask, what did they die for? What was the significance of their death? And I find it very difficult to think of it in any other way.
There's a difference between fear and terror. And combat, to me, at least initially, was sheer terror. You basically learned not to think in combat. If you took time to think, you were probably going to be dead. So you just operated on instinct. And at least I did.
One of my jobs allowed me to have an office in Singapore, and I would travel to Singapore from Los Angeles every couple months. And every time I flew to Singapore, I'd fly over Vietnam. I would look down at it. At that moment, when seeing it, I would say to myself, do I need to go back? Do I want to go back? What would I see? What would I do? What would it look like?
And yeah, I thought about it often, going back and passing out candy instead of bullets in the village we burnt down.
I decided, no, I don't think I need to go back. I've traveled the world, I love to travel, but it wasn't a need.
I think veterans are really grappling with, as they consider going back to Vietnam, which is, what was I fighting for? What did I lose in Vietnam? And how can I find it if I go back? I think that is sort of the issue.
And since then, I've realized that there's a hole in my travel, and it's Vietnam.
It's going to fill in a blank spot. That's what I think. Simple answer, but that's how I feel. I think it's going to fill in a blank spot in my life.
When Joe returns to Vietnam, I know what this trip means to him. He could have never gone back to Vietnam 10 years ago. He wasn't ready to do that. And I think the reason he's ready to do it now is because he understands that going back requires the same kind of bravery that it took to go to Vietnam in 1968 and 1969.
Thank you for bottom check the source. The cover, ladies and gentlemen, we will be landing shortly. Please share your seatbelt fastened.
Concerns? Absolutely not. I think it's going to be a wonderful trip. I had a beautiful young gal riding with me. But that was a picture of my wallet. She's going to be alongside of me. That's what makes it wonderful. I wouldn't go without her.
Joe and my journey started in 1963. I was in junior high school. We dated. We saw each other every day after his work, after my school. The draft was on. All the young men were leaving for the Army. And then the next thing we knew is he was on swift boats. But we really didn't know much about that.
Joe's mom, Joe, his dad, and me.
It's ironic that after 50 years, Joe's first trip outside the country was back to Vietnam.
I was stationed in Da Nang, and we patrolled from just south of Da Nang all the way up to the DMZ, the ocean. And when they went into the rivers and the canals down south, they asked for crews to volunteer to go. And my crew volunteered to go. And the whole ball game was different than patrolling the coast and the oceans. March 7th of 69, we were sent into the Kainap Canal via the Bayhop River. And the Bayhop and the Kulon both empty into the same bay on the southern end of the Kaumau Peninsula on the western side. I actually thought we were going ashore again when we made that right turn, and that's how thick the mangroves were. I didn't know what the hell was around the next corner, and of course I'm in the front of the boat, the very bow.
Ngày xưa đó, nếu nói cái tuyến sông đây là sông Kinh Sáng Cả Ngay, nhưng mà chiều ngang của nó khoảng chừng 30 mét thôi. Đó, còn cái kinh này, cái chỗ mình đang đứng có cây cầu đây đó, thì chiều ngang nó chỉ có chừng 2 mét ngoài, 3 mét vậy. Tức là cái đường sông, đường lưu thông nhỏ thôi. Chiếc tàu bê xếp thì nó đúng rồi, nó quay còn không muốn chở đầu, không muốn được nữa mà.
And we got almost to a village that was on our port side, which would be a left, and a rocket come flying across from the starboard side.
Rình đoạn này, khúc này, đánh cũng trận địa là đánh cũng khúc này luôn. Khi chiếc đi đầu thì bị đánh ở phía bên đó đó. Đánh nhưng mà bánh bị trượt.
Shrapnel went everywhere and my engine man got hit in the arm with a piece of shrapnel in his bicep. Nobody shot at us anymore. But we turned around, beached the boats, burnt that village to the ground. Is Bayhop River that way?
Chú ơi, đường đi thẳng lên là vào Bể Hạp đúng không ạ?
Bể Hạp.
Bể Hạp ạ. Yeah.
What are you thinking about?
Just thinking back as to when we were here in different time. I mean, I was, I think, either 20 or 21 at that time. Just thinking about being what we did.
You okay?
Yeah, I'm fine. I'm good.
I'm a little worried. I don't know how it's going to affect him. I don't know what he's going to feel, and I just want to be there.
So what they're looking for is a personal journey. No one has that same journey, but I think everyone has the hope that what they will find is a little bit of peace, a little bit of forgiveness, and that they can find the answers to questions that have lingered within them for so long. I think that's what the return does.
As we traveled down the Kainap, Joe scanned the shoreline for the site of the village that the soldiers burned to the ground 50 years ago.
Oh, yeah, well, yeah.
Yeah, I stepped there. That's okay. Not so bad. Hopefully I don't fall in.
The burning of the village wasn't the end to Joe's battle. The following day, they returned only to find themselves in more danger.
My boat officer starts screaming on the radio, my driver's hit. Well, nobody could communicate because he panicked. He's just screaming, my driver's hit. And finally, the driver crocked them and told them to shut up. A rocket came through the side of the boat, went through the refrigerator, came out the front of the freezer, and hit the fire extinguisher in the cabin. Then another rocket hits the back cabin of the boat, and the shrapnel just went everywhere. I actually had blood coming out my ears, I guess, and I was scared. Don't mind admitting it. You know, I was afraid back then, and I remembered that I was afraid. I was not afraid this time, but I remembered the feeling.
Xong cái nháp là trong đó còn có gọi là kinh đào, mà đây là kinh sáng cái ngay.
Hồi xưa thì ở đây xảy ra theo thông tin đó, tàu ba chiếc từ như này chạy xuống nè. Hướng từ cái keo sông Bãi Háp qua, khoảng đoạn gần chỗ này, du kích của Hàm Rồng đánh bệ 50 loại vũ khí tự tạo của địa phương. Trăm đầu đạn mới nổ, mới phóng.
So it is the rocket from the village to the boat, but they missed it. Is that right?
Well, it was on other side of village. Village here.
Yeah.
They over there shoot rocket this way.
Sau khi đó là tàu mới bắn là gặp những hàng cây này. Đồng thời là thiêu rụi cái làng này.
My journey on the Kainap Canal wasn't what I expected. To be perfectly honest with you, yes and no. My memory was somewhat different than the memory of the soldiers that fought here, but yet very much the same. And it's been 50 years now, and sometimes I don't remember what I went in the kitchen for, so.
Chú ý bảo là cái làng bị thiêu là đối diện so với cả cái phía mà bắn tên lửa sang. Rồi chú đang miêu tả với con rất đúng nhé, câu chuyện.
Nhưng mà bên kia cũng có mà một vài hộ.
We came back the next day after we burned the village, which would have been March 8th.
Yeah.
And we were supposed to play a tape on the loudspeaker telling them what wonderful guys we were. And, you know, we're thinking, do they have any idea what we left behind?
Yeah.
We knew we were going to get it. And were they involved in that ambush the next day when they attack our boats?
Bác thầy bác ấy có nói là bác ấy, đội của bác ấy thì bác ấy có quay lại vào cái ngày hôm sau.
Chú với chị Hoàng là cũng có áp nên đánh cái chiếc tàu đó đó.
Thì qua ngày sau là tụi tôi tiếp tục và tụi tôi đánh cho nên là ngày 8. Đây có người ba người đây hai có hai người.
Those people.
Hai người đánh
trong hôm sau. Involved.
Yeah,
involved. Well, what I would like to say is
đi đánh rồi đó vậy bắt tay cái đi.
Yeah, I come in peace this time. And
lúc đây là thù nhưng bây giờ là bạn rồi thì bắt tay đi không có gì.
We were enemy in the past, but now
yes,
we are friends.
Now we are.
We shake our hand for our friendship.
50 years ago, the villagers scattered when the soldiers arrived. Today, they came together.
Well, I think that was a profound experience for me to have my granddaughter here with me. Of course, she won't remember this, but she'll be able to see it on film.
Cha với ông rồi đó lội sông lạnh muốn chết bây giờ bay đi máy bay.
Smile for grandpa. Smile for grandpa. It's okay. I think the hardest part of meeting was getting on and off the boat. It was wonderful to meet them in peace after all these years. Hello. And my heart goes out to them because this was their backyard. I try to put the situation in reverse. What if they were in my house in Ohio, burning down my house? I would not like it. So, but I don't know any of these things when I'm 18 years old. When I'm 18, I don't think about that. I only think about staying alive. I honestly did not know that those were enemy soldiers. Nobody told me. And I was wondering, what are all these older Vietnamese people doing? And I didn't know that when we went to the first place. There was some difference in opinion as to which side of the river they attacked us from that first day, but other than that, our story's pretty well jived. And to find the exact spot and the people that were involved in the ambush was unbelievable.
One of the things that the Vietnamese can do for the Americans, and I've seen this over and over, is they can help them heal. They can help them find peace by forgiving them for what they did. And this is common. When veterans go over, so many of them want to say, I'm sorry, I never thought about the fact that you were someone else's son and that your life was as important as mine. And that, I think, is one of the most beautiful things I've seen as part of this experience.
Thanh Son Nhut Airport in Ho Chi Minh City bustles with international traffic, but this time with civilians instead of soldiers. We anxiously awaited John's arrival from LA.
The trip here was very long. I was lucky enough to have saved up some money a little bit, and I got a coach ticket into the business class. So I had room because of my broken leg. Broke my leg in two places, and I checked with my doctors, and I said, by October 1st, will I be able to walk? And they said, yes, you'll be able to walk. Maybe not a long ways, but you'll be able to walk. I decided to come, and whatever shape I was in by October 1st, that's it. That's what life has dealt me, and I'll do as much as I can.
John protested against the war. He didn't want to go to Vietnam, but today, he made the choice to come back.
The vibe on the plane going over was pretty quiet. I wasn't up on that Tet had started and that this today, tomorrow, when I land there, was gonna be a bad day. I don't think we had any concept of that clarity. But there was scares. There was a unspoken fear, I think, amongst most of the people on the flight. The minute you stepped off that plane, it wasn't like a get to know you kind of time. I was in it as I stepped off the tarmac. I was in the 1st to the 5th Mechanized Infantry, 25th Infantry Division, Tropic Lightning. They assigned us to platoons, and I might have 30 or 40 guys that I was the medic for them. And my whole life going forward from that moment was to keep these guys alive. When we came out of town and I had showing you that picture of the Black Virgin Mountain, and I knew that we were probably going to see it at some point. And the first time I saw it, it was like not an old friend, because it wasn't friendly, but it was an immediate right back in there, and it looked amazingly just like it did 50 years ago. And as we got closer and it got bigger in the frame, I got more emotional about it, starting to think about what went on at the base of it and the top of it and in between. And so it was an immediate icon that I could gravitate to that says, I'm here. It was getting dark, and our very first APC in the long line of maybe 20 vehicles got hit by an RPG and got taken out. And then it stops the whole thing. So now we're just sitting there. Incoming is coming from the rubber plantation just 100 yards away. They said there's somebody hurt in the first track, and I was the only medic I could find around. So I knew I had to get up to them. As I was taking care of them, there are other people getting hit as well. The company was in disarray. There seemed like there were bodies everywhere. And in my mind, I think there were 80 to 90 people dead. I think we had 175 people in the whole train.
Like the Black Virgin Mountain, rubber tree groves were iconic reminders of the war. It was here that John traveled back to a less peaceful time.
They're called Roman plows, and they just clear everything so nobody could sneak up on us. If they were coming, we could see them from a long distance away. Fighting really didn't take place in the rubber plantations much. The rubber plantations, we often would set up in little towns and around them, and the locals would come. And as medics, we would fix their wounds, and we would give them shots for plague and different maladies. So again, that made me feel better. So these aren't 50 years old. So these were planted. Yeah, but back there, see where it gets thick? That's probably where it was. And then when the war was over, they said, okay, we got all this cleared land, let's plant some more.
There's Joe, it's a surprise party, he didn't know.
He was on his way. We had a going away picnic for him at my parents' house.
Here's my dad. There's May. There's a cake my mommy made.
Yeah, I was definitely a different person. And I think when you interview Donna, she will tell you that the same person that she said goodbye to ain't what came home. And I couldn't communicate with her or anybody else.
Joe was very quiet when he came home. And I was a bouncy teenager. We just drifted apart.
When we got back together 29 years later, she said, if you would have talked, maybe things would have been different. And I said, what did you want me to talk about? I got 3 VC yesterday, it was neat. And what could I say that she would understand? And I hadn't come to grips yet either until I was about 30 and started educating myself on what the hell happened over there.
Just strange being back here.
And were you up in this area? Were you on the ground?
Well, we'd get off of the boat occasionally, yes. Be careful going down here. Ciao. I think it was just absolutely wonderful that I got to meet with the commander of the forces that I fought against. We just met in peace. We really didn't discuss war too much or fighting, and I hope I didn't anyway. How did he feel about attacking us? And truthfully, very truthfully. That was exactly me, and that's why you asked me why we split up when I came home. I didn't even know how to feel. Come on, monkey. Grandpa got it. Granddaughter. I could feel the love from him to my granddaughter. When he held her to sit with my enemy and we share love to my granddaughter, I felt nothing but peace from both sides.
My picture that I showed was just that gate, and that was the only thing. I don't even remember if this was here 50 years ago. I think I would have seen it, right? but we saw the gate, and it was the middle of nowhere. There was nothing else around. I had a little camera with me, and I would take a roll of film, and I would send it home to my mother, and she would just keep the pictures there. And at the end of the war, she gave me a whole booklet of all my pictures. And in one of them was a picture of the gates of a big temple. We were always instructed never to mess with the temples, don't do anything. But I captured the front gate of one. The world around it had changed immensely. It was just bomb craters and dirt around it. And now there's six lanes of traffic, no bomb craters, businesses. I was by here a lot. This was part of the route we took from Kuchi to Tainin. It was more grand and more unbelievable than I ever imagined.
I've seen a lot of churches, temples, cathedrals, mosques all around the world, and it absolutely blew me away.
We found out later that the Holy See has been here since 1926. But as often happens many times in war, the obvious was not always in plain sight.
Not only was it the temple itself, the physical structure, but the fact that there were maybe 300 worshipers in there and watching their coordinated chanting and movement and placement, and it was overwhelming. It was, your mind can't go to where it went. Seeing the plaque at the front that explained who the founders of this religion were, and that it wasn't based on a deity or a god as much as it was human compassion and virtues, was so refreshing and so interesting.
Been here since 1965.
Uh-huh.
Yes.
I was here in 1968. Very nice to meet you. Thank you. Thank you for allowing me to visit and to see the ceremonies and everything that went on. The last time I was here wasn't a good time. I probably wasn't welcome either. What a wonderful thing to meet him and to know that he was here when I was here. And when I come back, he's still here. Please tell him that this fills my heart and I'm very thankful, grateful. Okay, all right, thank you.
Since the start of the Tet Offensive, the number of wounded Americans in need of hospitalization has nearly doubled.
It was a raging battle, and at some point, I hear the word medic. I get my bag, and I head out running across the middle of the circle, heading for the soldier, and an RPG hit next to me. And I hear somebody say, "Doc, Doc, you're hit." There was no other medic to service me, so I was awake enough to tell them what to do. What had happened was a piece of metal about an inch and a quarter, very jagged scrap piece of metal, had gone into my neck, tumbled, tore out my nerves, and stopped a quarter of an inch from my jugular vein. So then my first thought is, this is it, my ticket home. I'm out of here. And about 2 weeks later, we were short of medics and they sent me out again. So my wound that I thought was my ticket home was nothing more than a little delay until I went back out into the war. So
I had my right knee replaced last December, and I didn't have this then.
Kuchi was a huge military base during the war. Today, it's been preserved as a tourist attraction. We decided that it should be here that John and Joe meet for the first time.
I'm a little claustrophobic. I don't know how many tunnels I'm actually going to be going in. We'll see.
Same with me. Well, I get dizzy if I close my eyes in the dark. Yeah. You out, don't you? So it was wonderful for me to do this with another veteran. Each person had a different experience in Vietnam, and what he did would scare the hell out of me, and I would guarantee you that if John got in the peak tank of a swift boat, it would scare the hell out of him. Following you, John.
How are we going? Look at this. Nice.
Christ. Yeah. You got to see this.
Well, this is thick like a hat with a machete getting yourself through anthills.
Was it like this or even thicker, John?
Even thicker than this. Yeah. Sometimes you'd have to turn around. You just couldn't go through it. Wow. You know, they poke their head up and take a shot, disappear. These vines.
To this day, I don't know why I was so stupid, but we came across a village just outside of Kuchi, and they signaled that they had found some tunnels. And I happened to be with a platoon that seemed to be 9 big guys and me. And I did it. And I, to this day, I mean, what if there was somebody there and killed me? But I went down head first, down in, and I think as soon as I got down, I realized I shouldn't be there. This isn't my job, and two is, I don't want to be there. So I got right out, and then I think we blew them up. You know, we tried to figure out how somebody got over the wire. Well, they didn't get over the wire, they got under the wire.
I wondered why they had showing this above.
Well, they may have romanticized it a bit. You know, as all winners of wars do.
Right, yeah, they write the history.
I would like to tell you about some former information about the tunnel, about the map and the tunnel system, how the tunnel system look like.
You know, in the wartime, the Kuchi is very important for both sides. The Vietnamese say that if the Kuchi is still here, they will be lost Saigon capital. That's why they attack Kuchi, whatever they have in the center. 500,000 tons of bomb driven here, in this area. Everything was burned down. We couldn't live in on the ground. Thanks to tunnel system, the Kuchi will put stay on the ground and defect it. And nowadays, we very rough up with our tunnel system. But we don't want to reuse it again.
Although we know the outcome, both sides have different ways of portraying the conflict.
Kuchi, the land of many gardens, peaceful all year round under the shady trees.
Wow.
Kuchi, the peace of
It was soon apparent that we were experiencing the point of view of the victors.
I'll be 100% honest with you. I became very upset. I came here in peace. What happened 50 years ago, as I mentioned before, was not good for anybody. And I could understand why the people of Vietnam would feel the way they do. But the men that I fought with, those are my brothers. We were pawns in this game, as I mentioned before. And it hurt me to watch a film where they were telling us that this woman received a medal for killing 15 American soldiers. That hurt me. The rest of it to me was very interesting, but I didn't want to see anything about killing my teammates.
Coming here and meeting Joe, he was quite different than me and in a different area. And I saw that today, going through here, it affected him very much. And then sometimes he would back off and walk away. And I knew that it was affecting him more than me. I'm glad to be here with him.
and to share with him and to be here for him if he needs to talk.
First, I would like you to come down there. We're coming out over there. Can you in? Please follow me.
1 meter?
Yeah. 1 meter high. You can come down there to see. Please.
Bob, I think you're going to have to respond.
No.
I'm not going down.
Who can go?
I realized that all these guys in my company and my squad and my platoon that I had become dear, dear friends with and learned about their wives and their kids and their girlfriends and all this. And then I'd lost like three of them in this battle. And I said to myself, I can't go forward investing so much in these people and knowing these people as well as I know them. It would be better if I didn't know them, if they were just numbers, or strangers, positions, then maybe it would be easier for me. And so I went to my men and I sat them down and I said, you know me as Doc, you know you come to me with everything. I said, you guys gotta stop that. I said, if you love me as much as you say you do, you can't burden me with your life, because when you're gone, I'll still have that. And so I said, unless you're hurt, don't call me.
Coochie really hasn't changed much since John was there 50 years ago. But now there are tour guides coming out of these tunnels instead of enemy soldiers.
The entrance was that size.
Uh-huh. Yeah. That's a real size. That's a real one.
Yeah. This is the area that I spent my 13 months in. So walking through the jungle was very much, except it was thicker then, but very much as if I was here then in 1968. There was no long-term thoughts of today, years in the future, or after the war. It was really about just getting through today, not stepping on anything, not getting hurt, and being there for other people because I was a medic. So my responsibility was to be there so that I could help other people. And those woods, and I visualize some of the battles, some of the fighting. It was terrible. So many friends are gone. Friends I haven't thought about in years. So this was pretty big. And now I don't know if I can go back. I probably changed. My bed has changed. For a while, I'll probably think of them where I hadn't thought of them for years. I'll think of them again.
For the last 2 months, I've been crying at home thinking about it, and I probably was much more emotional when you interviewed me in my Coast Guard uniform than I am now. And even when I went into the Kainep Canal, I didn't know what I was going to say. what do I say to somebody's home I burned down 50 years ago? And that's whatever I said, it just came to me. And I think it's because they didn't hold anything against me. And even the one old lady, she told me she was 14 years old when I burned her home down, and she wasn't angry with me.
My
villagers of the village that I burnt down, we were planting this tree in the new village that they had built, and several Viet Cong soldiers that were involved in ambushing me on March 8th, 1969, and March 7th also. That's who was present for it, and made me feel wonderful.
Cây này hôm nay là cây mai hoàng hậu. Mai là thể hiện sự may mắn và kết thúc là có hậu.
I think that what you explained about the tree is exactly what I felt here. I feel friendship and peace. It's sad that it ever had to happen, but we move on. It's been 50 years since I've been here, and I hope 50 years from now, Madeline comes and visits. That's pretty much what I have to say.
The fact that I was accepted by all of those people after what we had all been through. And, I consider myself a victim, too, of that war when I was a victim of my government. Because till the day somebody can give me a valid reason why I was there, why we gave 58,222 men, or how many more have been added, I'll continue to feel that way.
Peace. Peace. Peace.
We returned to Vietnam towards the end of the rainy season. The dreadful rain that many of us feared once would now bring life to Mai Hung Ho, the happy ending tree.
People like Joe are on the other side of the arc of life right now. I want Joe to live a long time, but it's my hope that he and other veterans, when they go back to Vietnam, become more whole. And by that I mean they can heal an emotional wound and that they can find the answers to questions that have lingered within them for so long.
Now when I lay my head on the pillow, I think of Mr. Bang and me sitting together and him holding my granddaughter. That's a lot nicer thought. What will I say to other veterans if they ask me if they should return or not? It's an interesting question.
Well, every soldier is different, and their experiences were different, and their horrors were different, and their losses were different. And so it's very hard to think of a mind of another soldier. And I would never tell anyone that thinks that they couldn't take it to come back, because here I thought I was well-adjusted. Nothing's going to bother me. I did good. And it affected me that you see how strongly it affected me. Well, I think that other soldiers, many other soldiers, couldn't take it. It wouldn't be good for them. And I don't think for many soldiers, it's a good idea to come back. It's a good idea to learn that the Vietnamese people are people like us, and people that forgive, and people that don't forget. But to go to a jungle, or go to a site, or go to the tunnels, or go to where they fought, I can't think that that's real good for a lot of soldiers.
The only thing I can tell them is the people will welcome you, that there's no war anymore. I can only tell them that it was okay for me to come, which might make them feel better, but There are people who sat behind a desk on a typewriter. Their name is on that Vietnam memorial because they were in the wrong place at the wrong time. My service is no more honorable than theirs. In fact, less honorable because they're dead and I'm not. So I would talk to a veteran, tell him it's okay to come, it's okay to do it, but you have to make your own decision. I had an awesome sense of pride. That's the difference between taking a life and saving them. So far, how has this journey been? It's all been absolutely wonderful. Everybody that I've met has been polite to me. I haven't found any rudeness, and if I tried to drive in this traffic that we rode in, I don't know how many times I'd have to give somebody the finger, but we think we have it bad, and we're angry when we drive, and people here are not.
We took our trip up to Hanoi. I really enjoyed Hanoi because it was more historical, a little more cultural. The lake in the center of town has a little park around it, and we were able to go down there and walk and casually under the trees see this wonderful place. And when I got tired, we'd sit down at the bench, and almost immediately we were approached by young children. And I mean children 4, 3, 4, 5 years old, wanting to speak English and coming up to us. And I found that different than anything I could imagine, but a wonderful thing. They'd look at their books and they'd read down and they'd say something like, "Where are you from?" And I remember specifically this one boy asked me that. And I told him that I was from California. And when I looked at him closer, he had a t-shirt on. And the t-shirt said Santa Monica, California. And I pointed to his belly and I said, "I'm from there." And he looked at his shirt and it was just surreal that here I am 15,000 miles around the globe and he's wearing a t-shirt from where I'm from. We all accumulate stories through our lives, and I've had some good ones, but this is a real good one, and this is gonna last for a while. And it certainly gave me a new perspective on Vietnam.